దూర విద్యా విధానంలో డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ ఓపెన్ యూనివర్సిటీ దేశంలోనే మొట్టమొదటి సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం. దాదాపు 2.5 దశాబ్దాలుగా దూర విద్యా విధానం ద్వారా కంప్యూటర్ కోర్సును అనుసంధానం చేస్తూ బిఏ బికామ్ బిఎస్సీ డిగ్రీ కోర్సులను అందిస్తోంది. పోస్ట్ గ్రాడ్యుయేషన్ స్థాయి డిగ్రీ డిప్లొమా స్థాయి కోర్సులను ఔత్సాహికులైన విద్యార్థులకు అందిస్తోంది. డాక్టర్ బిఆర్ అంబేద్కర్ సార్వత్రిక విశ్వవిద్యాలయం స్థానికంగా స్వయం బోధనా పద్ధతిలో ముద్రణ రూపంలో రూపొందించిన కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అందిస్తోంది. కోర్స్ మెటీరియల్ అధ్యయనానికి సహకరించే విధంగా రేడియో టెలివిజన్ పాఠ్యాంశాల ఆధారంగా కార్యక్రమాలు ప్రసారం చేస్తోంది. అధ్యయన కేంద్రాల ద్వారా ఏర్పాటు చేసే సలహా సంసర్గ తరగతులు సైన్స్ ప్రాక్టికల్ సౌకర్యాలు విద్యార్థులకు స్వయం అధ్యయనానికి ఒక చక్కటి అవకాశం. ఇవి విద్యార్థి సమీపంలో ఉండే అధ్యయన కేంద్రం నుంచే పొందొచ్చు.
Topic of today's live program is on secondary growth in plants and its importance. Now I introduce the two subject experts who are going to participate in this live program: Dr. Sudha, lecturer in the Department of Botany, Vanita Mahavidyalaya, Hyderabad. Second subject expert is Dr. Savita Rani, head Department of Botany, University College for Women, Usman University, Hyderabad. Regarding this subject, if you have any queries and doubts, please call on the following numbers. Please note down the phone numbers if you have any doubt to clarify. The phone numbers are 040-270-31431. The second phone number is 2703-1432. Third one is 2703-1433. There are lot of variation among the plants in terms of size, shape. Some plants are very small, microscopic in nature. Some plants are tallest. Some plants are having wider stem. I can take the one example. The smallest living organism that is a flowering plant on the globe is the Wolffia. It belongs to duckweed family, that is Limnaceae. The size of the Wolffia is less than 1 millimeter in size. The length it will vary from 0.6 millimeter to 0.5 millimeter, and the width of the Wolffia is less than 0.3 millimeter. On the other, there are few plants which will grow up to several feet in height, particularly Sequoia. It will grow up to 320-340 feet in height. Even in our state, the Pillalamardi, that is popular in Mahabubnagar district, it is also unique in having the one of the world's largest canopy in the three dimensional and two dimensional area. The biggest area it will cover, nearly 19,000 square feet area. Like that eucalyptus trees, which will also grow up to the 200 to 230 feet. Like that, there are many plants which will grow in height as well as in width. Why some plants grow in taller in height and why plants will have the bigger trunk? Before going into the details of all these things, we will discuss about what is the primary structure and what is the secondary structure of this one. I will start the discussion by posing a question to Dr. Sudha. What is primary structure, or what is the primary growth?
Growth is basically an irreversible increase in its size as well as its dry weight. So the primary growth is actually takes place in the plants with the activity of meristematic tissue placed in two apices, that is shoot apex and root apex. So the activity of these meristems will continue for a certain time and increase the length of the aerial system as well as the root system. Here the meristematic tissue is primary in origin, that means it is originated from the plant from the earliest stage and continues its activity for some time, and helps in the lengthwise growth of the plants. and here the meristematic tissue, when they are forming at the apices with the divisions, they add the tissue to the region and they get differentiated into the permanent tissue, which will perform the different functions, as we call them, as like they form tissue systems and then the organs. This is actually the primary body of the plant with the activity of meristematic tissue as a root apex and shoot apex.
What are the tissues involved in the primary growth?
If you see the organization in all the plants like the stem and the root and the leaf, you find basically three, they arrive from the three systems. So, they are arises from the promeristems. There are three different zones of the promeristems. There are the protoderm, which later transform into the epidermis, and the ground tissue, which forms the cortex, endodermis and pericycle in all the plant body. And the third important one is the procambium, which forms the vascular bundles, which consist of the complex tissues like xylem and phloem. So, these tissues, the xylem helps in the conduction of the water and the phloem helps in the conduction of the minerals and other fluids. So, if you see the basic organization of the all plants consists of epidermis, cortex, out the ground tissues, and inner you have the vascular bundles. So, this is commonly found in all types of the plant.
Have you any slides to show in support of this one?
Like if you see this, these are the primary meristems. You can just see that the apical meristems consist of protoderm, procambium, and the primary tissues are epidermis, ground tissues, and later they forms the lateral meristems, vascular cambium and carcambium, that we will see in the secondary growth.
Dr. Sudha, can you explain the what is the primary structure in stem?
The tissue organization in stem is different, both in dicots and monocots. The vascular bundles of the dicot stem, they are arranged in a ring like manner at the periphery, leaving a medulla, that is a characteristic feature, and the vascular bundles are described as conjoint, collateral, open and arc. They are called open because they consist of a cambium, and that is basically the structure of the dicot stem. Here you can see both the pictures of a dicot stem transverse section, where we can see the vascular bundles in a periphery and arranged like a ring like manner. And the other one is the monocot stem, where the vascular bundles are scattered, that is considered to be more advanced anatomically as well as functional wise. And main another difference with the monocot vascular bundles are, the vascular bundles are conjoint collateral, but closed, and of course, endarch being the stem. Closed because there is no cambium in the monocots. So, this actually leads to the topic we are going to discuss future. Like the secondary growth is absent in monocots due to this absence of cambium in the vascular tissues.
What about the primary structure in the case of the root?
If you see the primary structure of the root, there is two, one thing, one is the morphologically and internally. So, morphologically there is a clear differentiation of the root structure in the dicot and the monocot. In the dicot you have the taproot system. We can see the structural differences between the root systems, that is in monocots you have the fibrous root system. This is the morphologically. But if you see the internal structure consists of similar structures, but only thing is there is a little variation when compared to the stem. The uppermost layer, we call it as an epiblema or filiferous layer in the root, and followed by this we have the ground tissue, that is the cortex, which is more of homogeneous and it is in a simple tissue in most of the roots. And the distinct feature of the roots is presence of a endodermis with Casparian thickenings and few passage cells. So, these passage cells helps in the diffusion of the fluids. You can see the diagram that explains the differences between the dicot and monocot stem. So, the structurally they have the similar, but the internally if you see the stellar regions, the vascular bundles are arranged in alternate, that is the clear xylem and phloem bundles are alternate with each other and they are arranged in the radial manner. And if you see the, and the most important difference between the stem and root is the xylem, that is the exarch xylem you will see. What does it mean by the exarch xylem? That is, the protoxylem is present towards the periphery and the metaxylem is present in the center. So, this is the main difference between the root and the stem. But in between these two, if you see the dicot and monocot, the vascular bundles are limited in number in the dicots. So, that is range from 2 to 4, we call it as a diarch to tetrarch conditions. And because of this presence, and you can scarce absent of fifth, or if it is present, very less amount is present. Whereas in the monocot, there are many vascular bundles are present, you can see in the diagrams, and that means we call it the polyarch conditions of the vascular bundles, and the clear pith you can see. So, this is the fundamental difference between the root of dicot and monocot of primary structures. Vascular bundles are diarch to tetrarch conditions with no pith in the dicots, and polyarch conditions of vascular bundles with a clear pith, this is a monocot root. So, this is the primary organization of the root in monocots and dicots.
Is it similar in all the root systems, the primary structure? It will vary from plant to plant?
Of course, the primary structure is similar in all of them, but there are certain variations you can observe. So, the variations is you can see in is that, for example, in some of them, what we call is an aerial roots are present. So, in buttresses roots, we call in some of them which gives the protection to the stem, and there are some roots in the velamen roots which are present in epiphytes. So, internally these tissues consist lot of spongy tissues, and you can see in the pneumatophores, that is the Avicennia plant, halophytes, where there is lot of air spaces are there, and some of the roots like carrot, beetroot or the storage roots, we have the lot of parenchyma is there. So, these are the some variations you observe, otherwise all the structure remains same in the roots.
But between these monocot and dicot root, is there any difference in the primary structure?
The primary structure difference is in the number of vascular bundles, the polyarch conditions in the monocot and diarch to tetrarch conditions in the dicot, and the presence of clear pith is a characteristic feature of the monocot root.
So, we will enter into the main topic of today's discussion, that is the secondary growth. So, Dr. Sudha, please explain what is the secondary growth.
Secondary growth is occurs with the activity of the cambium present in the vascular tissue, or otherwise earlier as we mentioned, the meristematic tissue present in the from the beginning, that will help in the primary growth. And the secondary growth actually occurs with the formation of secondary tissues, that is the meristematic tissue, plus it also increases the grit of the trunk of the plants. Earlier I said the meristematic tissue of the apical shoot apex and root apex increase the length of the plants. Here as the plant grows older, and they need increase of the circumference also, that is mainly with the activity of the cambium arising as a secondary. So, as it forms later, it is called secondary tissue, and the tissues which are formed in due to the activity of these tissues are also called as secondary tissues.
Okay, what are the tissues involved in the secondary growth?
The main tissue which is involved in the secondary growth in the stem and root is like the cambium, that is the vascular cambium and carcambium. Vascular cambium is the one which forces the secondary growth in the stellar regions, that it produces secondary xylem and secondary phloem. And the carcambium produces the extra stellar region secondary growth, that it results in the periderm. So, basically the cambium, which is this meristematic activity, produces all these secondary tissues, that is the secondary xylem and phloem and the periderm. So, the main tissue which is involved in the secondary growth is the cambium.
Yeah, we can say as formation of vascular cambium and also formation of carcambium. These are the major events in the secondary growth, sir. Like vascular cambium increases the vascular tissue, forms a secondary xylem and secondary phloem, and the carcambium increases the secondary cortex, and the outside it forms the carc. So, these are the two major tissues which are contributing for the secondary growth, both in stem as well as in roots.
Explain in detail about the what are the process of the secondary growth in stem. Yourself.
here secondary growth in stem, as we already mentioned this earlier also, this takes place only in dicots, not in monocots. Dicot stem secondary growth begins with the actually initiation of the cambium, which is already exists between the xylem and phloem. As we said, it is a fascicular cambium. From the beginning it is present, so it is primary in origin. Then when the secondary growth initiate, the main thing is just opposite to the vascular cambium, that means between the two vascular bundles, the medullary rays, which are of parenchymatous in nature, that cells transform into meristematic again. We call it as a de-differentiation. That means the permanent tissue again is becoming meristematic here, and it actually make a patch wise between the vascular bundles. So this is called intrafascicular cambium. So the fascicular cambium and interfascicular cambium together forms the cambial ring, as you can see the colored photograph here. In the beginning, the vascular bundles are separate, that is the primary structure. When the interfascicular cambium, that means the medullary rays part opposite to the cambium, which is also becoming meristematic, it makes a complete ring, that is the vascular cambium. So, as the vascular cambium initially observed to be only one cell in thickness, but as the activity starts and produce as the differentiation of the cells to form the secondary vascular tissues, it will be just called as a zone, meristematic zone. In fact, not only one layer thick, it will be many cell thick at that point of time. So, characteristically the vascular cambium produces secondary xylem inside, which is in the centripetal manner, that is towards the center, and towards the outside it produces secondary phloem, that is in the centrifugal manner, that means from the center to the outside. So, these secondary xylem and secondary phloem are characteristically produced by the vascular cambium, not in equal amounts. This is approximately 4:1, that is secondary xylem produced inside is always more, and the secondary phloem produced outside is relatively less. And that is why the secondary xylem, which is going to be towards the center and occupies the core of the stem, will be called as the wood. Secondary xylem is actually called as wood, that is having the commercial importance as a matter of fact. So, this is completed with the formation of vascular tissue at the center, but when the tissues are adding at the center, it need to meet the periphery also need to expand, otherwise it will be lot of pressure on the surrounding cells. So, correspondingly when the tissues are secondary tissues are formed at the center, that is the vascular tissue, from the cork region again here also the parenchymatous cells de-differentiate into meristematic, and here a clear ring will be formed from the cortex region. This is secondary in origin. In the beginning I said the vascular cambium partially primary in origin, and that is fascicular cambium, and intrafascicular cambium is secondary in origin, but the cork cambium, which is produced from the cortex region, completely secondary in origin. That is one difference. And the cork cambium here as a ring like it is formed, the meristematic tissue like it acts and produces the secondary cortex inside and the cork cells outside. So, here the cork cambium is also called as phelloderm, and the secondary cortex is phelloderm, and the cork produced outside is called as phellum. So, the phellogen, that is the cork cambium, and the secondary cortex phelloderm, and the phellum, the cork, together is called as periderm. Then commercially also we many times mentioned about a bark, which is happened to be seen on the older trees, which is obviously a hard structure seen. So, this bark is actually comprising of this periderm plus the secondary phloem, together is called a bark. So, this is actually the gist of the secondary growth takes place in dicot stems.
As you said, this is a lateral meristem consists of vascular cambium as a cork cambium. These two meristematic cambium will work together simultaneously as well in the cortex region as well as in the stellar region,
or stellar
one
region,
after the other?
It actually initiate in the stellar region, sir.
Yeah.
So, once the secondary tissues are produced at a later stage, the cork cambium will be initiated and starts its activity, because the center cells when they are adding, exactly at the pace the growth circumference increase as it needed, it will be initiated.
So, coming to the secondary growth in root, is it similar to the stem, or is there any difference? If so, in what way?
Actually, what are the tissues produced in the secondary growth of the stem also produced in the roots? That is the secondary xylem, secondary phloem in the stellar regions and periderm in the extrastellar region. But there is a lot of variation in the process of secondary growth in the roots. As we already told that secondary growth takes place only in dicotyledons and it is completely absent in the monocot roots. So, here in the monocot, in the dicot root, the cells which are present beneath the phloem bundles, they become meristematic in activity and they produce a strip of the cambium. And the number of strip of cambium is exactly equal to the number of the phloem bundles. This is the first stage of the division of the process of secondary growth. Meanwhile, the cells from the pericycle, which are just opposite to the protoxylem groups, they becomes active and meristematic and they produces a strips of cambium. So, the first strip of cambium is produced from the beneath the phloem bundles and the second strip is produced from the cells beneath the protoxylem groups. So, in the process of development, both the cambium extends together and they form a ring, complete ring. The first formed ring is in wavy. You can see the diagram of that, the process of secondary growth. You can see the clearly the wavy nature of the cambial ring, the first formed. As we have already mentioned in the stem, that during the process of secondary growth, a lot of xylem, secondary xylem is produced than the secondary phloem. That means the more of xylem is produced. So, because of this activity, whatever the wavy line of cambium produced in the first, later it becomes a circular. So, once the cambium activity begins, it produces the secondary xylem towards the center and secondary phloem towards the outside. So, this is the first stellar secondary tissues are formed. So, once there is a formation of the secondary tissues in the stellar regions, in root it is little different from the stem. In the root, that is pericycle, the cells of pericycle, they becomes meristematic and they acts as a cambium and produces the periderm in the outside region. The structure of periderm consists of clearly to the same of the stem, that is the phloem, cork and phelloderm inside. So, this is the process of secondary growth formation in the dicot root. So, this is a completely the process is different because we know that the vascular bundles in this are alternate. That is, you have the phloem and xylem and separate, they are not collateral vascular bundles. That is the reason the development of secondary growth is completely different from the stem in case of the roots. So, this is about the secondary growth.
Just now you have mentioned about the periderm. The periderm is formed due to the activity of the cork cambium. Actually, what is bark?
The bark is the reason, as I said, is a periderm plus the secondary cortex together is called as bark. There are even commercially useful
is
barks
it a
are also
living
there.
Tissue?
If it is included the secondary phloem, it will be living. Otherwise, it is the cork is completely made of soberin made cells and
actually okay. the word cork is loosely used in terms,
yeah.
So most of the time they think that periderm is the cork. It is not that one. The cork is the tissue which is the cells beyond the cork cambium. All the layers behind the cork cambium we call it as a cork. So, sometimes they use as a dead cell, it is not the correct, but all the cells behind the cork cambium, actively growing cork cambium, we call it as a bark, which includes the periderm also.
So, because due to formation of the bark, there is no scope for gaseous exchange. So, how this gaseous exchange problem will be resolved?
So, the important one which is that we can see lot of lenticels on the periderm on the stem. So, what exactly the lenticels? Lenticels, or the name itself gives, that is the lens shaped highly raised regions. So, the highly raised regions present on the periderm and on the stem. So, the main function of the gases of this lenticels is to promote exchange of gases. So, the structure of lenticel, if you see, they have a small pore which is surrounded by loosely arranged cells. So, they helps in the exchange of gases, and this is the reason you find lot of lenticels in which the plant is having the more secondary growth, which is having the periderm.
You can see some of the slides also.
You can show this slide.
So, lenticel, if you take the origin of lenticels, they mostly they arrives beneath the stomata. The structure, if you see that they have beneath the stomata, I will just show the structure of the lenticels. This is the structure of lenticels. You can see it helps in the exchange of gases. And this because of this cork cambium only the lenticels are produced. And one of the important factor is that these lenticels are reported only on the plants which is having the secondary growth. But exceptionally, lenticels are present in the roots of nematophores, that is the plants growing in the halophytes, because they requires the exchange of gases. So, you can see the how the rupture of the cells and the loosely arranged cells of the lenticels.
Dr. Sudha, explain in detail about the annual rings or growth rings.
When the secondary tissues are formed, they are also affected by the seasonal variation, and the plants in the spring season, there will be lot of activity, the formation of new leaves, buds and flowers, everything. So, the cambium is very active and they need lot of water as well. So, here the xylem elements which are produced in the spring season will be large with thin wall, and also the area formed of the secondary xylem will be more. So, this is usually called as spring wood or early wood, and when it is in the winter season, there is not much activity to form the new leaves, and a lot of leaves will be also shed. So, because the less activity and also less amount of water available, the xylem elements produced there are very with the less lumen and also with more thick wall, and the zone formed in that during that time also will be small. So, when there is a seasonal variation in one year, that will be reflected in the formation of these secondary tissues formed in the spring season, which is called early wood, and in the autumn season it is called late wood. So, these are concentrically formed in the stem region. So, the rings which are formed in one year, they are called as annual rings. You can see in the picture, that is just one after the other concentric rings of this early wood and late wood are formed. So, these rings are actually can be used to assess the age of the trees, which is also called as dendrochronology, very useful. But sometimes these annual rings are not so distinctly formed in the tropical region, because the seasonal variation is not so contrast. So, mainly here deciduous trees which are growing in the temperate region forms the very clear rings, but the plants which are growing in our region like Tectona grandis and Albizia, then these are the plants can form very clear rings. That is why the teak wood is also very valuable because of the formation of that annual rings.
On the basis of the number of annual rings, we can tentatively assess the age of the plant. But it is not clear in all the plants. As you said, in the tropical areas, it is very difficult
very
to distinguish between the rings. So, there is another term, that is, what is a sap wood? What is hardwood?
So, if you see that the more of secondary growth is going on, the more amount of the xylem, that we call it as a wood, is produced. So, if you cut a tree, then we can see a clear demarcation of the two zones, which you can see in the central region there is a more dark brown in color, and the peripheral region it is a light brown in color. A clear demarcation you can see. So, the peripheral region is the one is the wood which is formed recently, and that is the reason we call it as an sapwood. And then the central one consists of the older, that is elderly formed wood. If you see the structure of wood, the recently wood also have some living cells, so the helps in some of the physiological activities also. But the centrally formed sapwood is of only provides the mechanical strength, it will not give any sort of transport. So these are the two clear zones you can see, sapwood and heartwood. The sapwood is also known as albumen and the heartwood is known as the duramen. So if you cut any tree, you can see the clear two zones of sapwood and the heartwood, which are distinguished by their dark and light shades of the wood.
You can see the picture also.
You can see the picture, it is very clear. You can see the peripheral light in the brown color and the central heartwood, which is very, very dark in color. So, this type of wood, the outer one is the sapwood and the central one is the heartwood.
So, when it comes to the secondary wood, there is a lot of economic importance associated with that. For any ship industry or housing industry, timber will play a major role. Can you elaborate it further, the importance of the timber in our applications?
So that the wood which we call is nothing but the xylem. So the wood is nothing xylem, the secondary xylem which is produced due to the secondary growth. So that what we call wood or the timber is consist of mostly of the secondary xylem, and which is of importance for the all what we can use as a furniture or any use. So it has the high value of the timber. So the wood what we call is nothing but the secondary xylem, which is of high commercial and agriculture and other uses.
Okay. So now, so far we have discussed about the primary growth in the plants. And what is the secondary growth? What are the lateral meristems that are involved in the secondary growth? What are the different types of woods, tyloses, lenticels? And before going into the details of the, is there only secondary growth or any other growth in addition to deviation from the secondary growth that is existing in the plants? Dr. Sudha?
Normal secondary growth, as we explained, with the activity of the formation of vascular cambium and carcicambium, forms the secondary tissues, vascular tissues, as well as the secondary cortex and carcer. But there are actually in nature there are some anomalous primary structures itself. Definitely they are going to be different in their secondary growth. So, some of the examples we will give you, like anomalous primary structures itself. As we said, normally in the dicot stem, the vascular bundles are arranged in a ring like manner, but there are some plants where the vascular bundles are scattered, like the monocots in fact. So, that occurrence of scattered vascular bundles is seen in Nymphaeaceae, Papaveraceae members like that, which is a rare feature. And another one is presence of medullary bundles is also seen. This is also mentioned in the families like Amaranthaceae and Cynopodiaceae members. And in certain members, there is a presence of cortical bundles also. That means, apart from the vascular bundles, there is also the presence of vascular bundles in the cortical region. So, something like family Casuarinaceae and Nyctaginaceae are the best examples for this. And in some members of angiosperms, here as we are discussing the secondary growth and all, there is no vessels in the xylem, which is a rare feature. Actually, the gymnosperms are devoid of vessels, but all the angiosperms will have vessels in their xylem elements. Vessels means the conducting elements which are having the perforations on both the end walls. So, those xylem vessels are absent in certain families. The best examples like Winteraceae and Trichodendraceae members. So, there will be a different kind of secondary growth in them. And in some members, there will be an inclusive of phloem and xylem bundles. That means, they will have their own normal vascular bundles. But they have either only the xylem bundles or only the phloem bundles. Like in Cuscuta, it is apart from its original vascular bundles, they will have few bundles with only phloem. And a Paeonia, a Caryophyllaceae member, where only the xylem bundles are seen apart from its original ring of vascular bundles. So these are presence of some exclusive phloem or xylem bundles. Similarly, polystele condition, this is very rare in angiosperms, only found in the pteridophyta member group of members, but here like nymphaeaceae is one best example where there will be many number of steles, particularly as we know Victoria aerisia will be having known as with largest leaf. So that plant actually having numerous steles, that is a polystelic condition, that is very rare feature. Then occurrence of internal vascular bundles is also seen. These are actually anomalous primary structures, and naturally when there is so many primary anomalous structures are seen, so the secondary growth also tend to be different or deviating from the normal secondary growth. So whichever is deviating the normal growth, as we said, the formation of vascular cambium and cork cambium, instead of that any deviation is called anomalous secondary growth.
So when compared to secondary growth, anomalous secondary growth is a rare phenomenon.
It occurs in many families,
particularly in stems.
Yeah,
most
in
of the stems. Yes. What about the anomalous secondary growth in roots?
So the anomalous secondary growth is not that frequently observed in the roots compared to the stems, but there are also anomalous secondary growth observed in the storage roots and fleshy roots. We have seen the storage roots like the beetroot, carrot, and sweet potato. So all these, they are having the storage parenchymatous tissues. So in this, the what exactly they mean by anomalous secondary growth is any form of deviation of the cambial activity, which is different from the normal. So if you see the structures of anomalous secondary growth in the root of the beetroot, you can, if you cut the beetroot, you can see the two different concentric layers of the tissues. So this is formed by the due to the activity of the cambium. So all these tissues produces a massive amount of storage parenchyma for the organs for the storage. So if you see the structure of internal structure of the beetroot, you can see, if you cut it, you can see the concentric rings of the vascular bundles as well as the storage parenchyma. So what is the abnormal activity on the beetroot? So the first, it forms the cambium and it forms the second primary vascular bundles, and this also includes the production of large amount of the parenchymatous tissues. So the first formed cambium is very active, and it produces more number of vascular bundles, but after that it becomes slows down. And the newly formed cambium, it becomes more meristematic and produces more number of the vascular bundles. That means you have a alternate rings of the vascular bundles along with the storage parenchyma. So that is the abnormality you can see in the beetroot. In the similarly, you can see in the root of sweet potato. If you see the sweet potato, the first the function of the cambium is normal. It produces normal vascular bundles like normal phloem, normal xylem it produces. But once it produces massive amount of the parenchymatous, it produces more number of vascular bundles along with the production of parenchymatous tissue in both the directions. So if you see the sections of this, you can see lot of storage parenchyma, because we know basically these are the storage roots, they have to store the food products, and that is the reason this type of anomalous structures you can see in the sweet potato as well as the beetroot. Similarly, in the carrot and the radish, where they are the fleshy organs, a lot of massive production of parenchymatous tissue observed. So this form of anomalous structures you observe in the roots, but in case of stems there are many examples which they, you can, I think will tell there's lot of abnormalities are associated with the stem, but this type of abnormalities only observed in the root in case of that.
That is, secondary growth is very common among the gymnosperms and angiosperms, but rarely we can see in the lower plants like either in algae, fungi, bryophyte, but rarely we can see. So, what is the advantage of having the secondary growth for these plants? Is there any advantage to the plant? Any advantage to all of us? We will get the very quality wood, that is okay. In what way the secondary growth will help the plant, that particular plant?
Actually, secondary growth is seen only the plants where the vascular tissue is there, sir. So, first land plants are pteridophytes, but all the pteridophytes are not showing secondary growth. Only an example is isoites, where secondary growth is observed, but in gymnosperms secondary growth is almost like the dicot members or angiosperms, but the difference in the gymnosperms the secondary growth is there is no xylem parenchyma like thing, and also it forms a soft tissue, commercially it is called a soft tissue, and it is non-porous wood also it is called. So, it is that wood is useful only to make the this plywood and other things with the wood pulp we can make, but actually in the angiosperms the wood formed through the secondary growth is different, which is called as porous wood and non-porous wood. So, the secondary growth, as we mentioned so long, why it has taken place, because it needs the plants are very perennial, they grow very tall, and aerial parts need to have the mechanical strength. So, here the secondary tissues, as we said, lot amount of secondary xylem is produced. So, that secondary xylem is in fact the wood which give the mechanical support to the plants. As madam said earlier, sapwood and heartwood. Sapwood is the actually the conducting zone, and the heartwood is not going to be in conductional no more. It is just gives the mechanical support and provides the strength which needs to stand. That is
Hello.
Yes, tell me. Yes, yes, you ask the question.
Sir, secondary growth is occurring in angiosperms.
Secondary growth?
Occurs in angiosperms.
Sir, secondary growth angiosperms are there, sir.
Yes. Yes.
Sir, secondary growth will occur in angiosperms, plants are not.
Yes. It occurs. It occurs in angiosperms.
Hello.
Secondary growth very much occurs in angiosperms, also in gymnosperms. What is your question? You elaborate it further. Actually, what do you want?
No, continue.
Okay.
So this is the significance of secondary growth is very important. That being making the plants perennial and also to withstand the environmental conditions as well, as it forms the bark and cork other tissues.
Okay. Even among the angiosperms, the annuals, bianuals, particularly in the herbs, and rarely in few shrubs only we can see the secondary growth. Mostly it is confined to the
trees.
Bigger trees in the case of the gymnosperm and angiosperms. You show some of the slides.
So, these are abnormal. Actually, in the beginning itself we said the secondary growth occurs in dicot plants, not all dicot plants again. It is only the woody or shrubby plants. So, herbaceous dicots and monocots are devoid of secondary growth, and as we mentioned, some of the secondary growth is deviating from the normal secondary growth, and we call them as abnormal secondary growth. The deviations can be mentioned like the cambial activity, the formation of cambium and normal position of the cambium, but abnormal activity, that is one type, sir. Like the most common examples are Aristolochia and Bahinia like plants, where the cambial activity is slightly different. In its position it is the same like the other plants, but the activity wise only the fascicular cambium produces the vascular tissue, and the intrafascicular cambium makes only the parenchymatous tissue. So, between the secondary elements or the secondary tissues, the parenchymatous medullary rays are produced, which gives flexibility to the wood. So, that is abnormal behavior of the cambial ring, that is one form, and another one is abnormal position of the ring, and as well as abnormal behavior. So that means the cambial ring forms either from the cortical region or from the pericycle, and even the production of the secondary tissue is also different, as we can see the examples of Salvadora and few slides. This is the extrastellar cambial ring also can be produced. So this is very typical, in fact occurs in normal herbaceous plants, as you know Amaranthus and Acaranthus, Cynopodium, these are all the plants which are very herbaceous, but still they have the anomalous secondary growth. So here the cambial ring forms away from the stellar region, either from the cortex, and repeated divisions of this cambial ring formation leads to the development of secondary tissues. And this is a formation of included phloem. This is seen in the cambial activity, variation in the cambial activity, like the examples of Salvadora and Leptodenia and Sargania. Here the cambial ring is much folded, so it almost becomes like a meristeel like. Here as you can see, it does not form a continuous ring of a single one. The central one is the bigger ring, surrounded by many peripheral rings. That means each one is a single steel like it forms, and even the carcacambium also correspondingly it forms. So this is a very peculiar phenomenon seen in certain Salvadora, like a Sapindus member of a tendrilar climber. So here some of the abnormalities are actually providing some adaptive feature, either as lion or climbers they have secondary tissues, but the secondary tissues as they provide more mechanical strength, they will be more hard. So when they need some flexibility, this kind of abnormalities are found. This is a formation of extra xylary cork is also found. That means in between the secondary xylem layers, cork tissue is also produced. So this is the best example is Aclea, and Artemisia is another member, but in Aclea we can see the picture. So here you can see between the vascular bundles secondary xylem, again one cork ring is formed. So as the cork is produced between the xylem rings, it is called intraxillary cork, very abnormal in this case. And a few more prominent examples of anomalous secondary growth are mainly the normal formation of the cambial ring, but abnormal behavior. As we know, Bahinia is one example where the cambium, instead of forming the secondary xylem inside, at different specific points it produces only the phloem. So in Bahinia it forms four bands of phloem in the xylem region, that makes some flexibility to the stem. Similarly, we know about Bahinia valley, Liana. So Liana plants are actually woody climbers, are called Lianas. They show this abnormal growth. So in Bahinia, the cambial ring is actually very much folded, and it is formed into small pieces, like it is not a continuous ring like secondary xylem would.
Yes.
Hello, sir. Angiosperms lo secondary growth ela jarugutundi?
Dentlo?
Angiosperms lo secondary growth ela jarugutundi?
సార్ మనం ఇంతవరకు మాట్లాడుతున్నది చాలా వరకు యాంజియోస్పోమ్స్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్స్ తీసుకొని డిస్కషన్ చేస్తున్నాము. నౌ షీ విల్ ఎలాబరేట్ ఇట్ వన్స్ అగైన్.
యాక్చువల్లీ వాట్ వి హావ్ గివెన్ ద సెకండరీ గ్రోత్ ఇన్ ద స్టెమ్ అండ్ రూట్ ఇస్ టేకింగ్ ద ఎగ్జాంపుల్స్ ఆఫ్ యాంజియోస్పోమ్స్ ఓన్లీ. అండ్ ద సెకండరీ గ్రోత్ ఇన్ యాంజియోస్పోమ్స్ అండ్ జిమ్నోస్పోమ్స్ ద ప్రాసెస్ ఇస్ సేమ్. సో యాంజియోస్పోమ్స్ మీన్స్ లెట్ ఆల్ ద ప్లాంట్స్ వాట్ యూ కెన్ సీ అరౌండ్ ఇజంట్ ఇట్. So all this you have the similar type of the secondary growth, angiosperms, flowering plants, all those, isn't it? So what we have explained is secondary growth in angiosperms. Is it clear for you?
Yes. Are you satisfied with the answer?
Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, having the secondary growth, plant have an advantage. So what is the main importance of the secondary growth that the plant it produces? Importance of the secondary growth.
Okay, and just before going into the some of the importance of secondary growth, I would like to add what is related to the stylosis. That is one of the important structures we missed it in secondary growth. The stylosis are nothing but the parenchymatous cells of the xylem and pterygium. They excludes form into the stricary elements and forms a balloon like structures. So these balloon like structures grows pretty well and they completely blocks the lumen of the tracheids. So this is an important structures where the majority of the storage they can use as a store of phenolics and oils and other. So this is a one of the styloses or the one of the important structures associated with the secondary growth, and they also adds to the durability of the wood. How they adds to the durability of wood is once they grow and blocks the complete lumen, then they stops the function that is the flow of fluids and also the flow of bacteria or flow of fungi mycelium. So this is the one of the important structures which adds to the durability. And coming to the importance of secondary growth, the one of the important of secondary growth is the xylem, that is the wood. What we use is commercially, the wood is the result of the secondary growth. This is the one of the important. And the second important is the secondary growth adds much to the volume or the girth or the diameter of the stem. Because we have seen the plants which are having very, very long plants. So this will bear all the weight of the aerial pots. So that is the one of the important character or important significance of the secondary growth.
We can show the stylosis pictures.
Yeah. So meanwhile, one other important function of the secondary growth is like the secondary growth protects the internal tissues. We know that the secondary growth results the periderm or the bark or the secondary tissues above the stem, and they protect the internal tissues from biotic as well as the abiotic stress. Biotic stress means the causing of organisms like the bacterial, fungal, other biotic organisms, insects, and abiotic stress is related to the environmental factors, that is extreme conditions, temperature, etc. So these are the three important functions of the secondary growth. One is it produces a lot of wood for the commercial point of view, and second it protects the internal tissues, and third most important is it bears all the aerial weightage of the plants. This is the main important use of the secondary growth in plants. Anything you would like to add for that?
Stylosis pictures we can show to the students later. Okay. The okay, xylem intrusions, parenchymatous intrusions into the vessels, which completely blocks the lumen. As madam said, they increase the durability of the wooden. So these are actually the stylosis.
Okay, I'll just focus the cell. This is the important structures.
The stylosis, so which are seen in the vessels, they are formed mainly in vessels, but also can be seen even in the tracheids also, sir. So this is actually the second one. Red color is the white is vinifera, that is a grape vine, that is the stylosis formed when it is the parenchymatous cell nucleus and protoplasm also enters the vessel, but enlarges there, and later it forms the thick wall layer also. So it blocks and it makes the cell not penetrable to water, as well as madam said, any bacterial infection or fungal infection, that makes the wood more durable. So that's a very peculiar phenomenon seen in the plants as a defensive mechanism in its own.
So as you said, this barky cork will protect from environmental calamities, like it will also protect from disease causing agents due to the several thickness of the cork. But in addition to that, the secondary growth will also add new transporting tissue or conducting tissue. This is another important feature of the secondary growth. It will add the conducting tissue by replacing the non-functional old ones, so that as the plant grows tall and tall, the additional requirement of the supply of the water and sap is taken care by the production of the new conduct tissue by the secondary growth. Now, we know there is a lot of applications of the secondary growth and the significance of the secondary growth. As we said, it is very common among the gymnosperms and angiosperms. If somebody is interested to see the tallest plants and the widest plant, the best place is to go to the Californio, California, where there is a Muir Woods, there is a very big garden protected by the federal government of USA. You can see the tall plants, it will go up to 200 to 250 feet, and the width, that the width of the stem is also up to 30 to 40. So, sometimes even there are few trees, I think the name of the tree, this is the one of the widest trunk on the in the world. The name of the tree is it is Arbol del Tule tree. Arbol del Tule tree, the width of the trunk is more than 40 feet. I think this is the highest record. It is very much present in the center of the town of Santa Maria. It is in the Mexico City. Now, it is about the age of the plant, they mentioned about more than 1400 years. I think there are many plants in the California state as well as the Nevada state, each plant will grow up to 300 to 350. The sequoia, the giant sequoia is one very good example. It will grow up to 200 to 250, and the dia of the stem also varies from 14 feet to 30 feet. So, keeping in view of the importance of these things, even as I said in the beginning, some plants even in our country, that is eucalyptus is one of the very good example, it will also grow up to 200 to 300. Even so called bamboos belongs to Gramini family will also grow up to 100 to 150 feet. So, in view of the importance of the secondary growth, that has immense applications of the secondary growth as in the terms of the wood. That is the reason there is a lot of economic importance to the secondary wood. So, with this we have covered the importance of the secondary wood, what are the different plants in which we can see the secondary growth, and in addition to that there is deviation from the secondary growth, the anomalous secondary growth. I will conclude by saying one thing, that is, let us agree on one thing, that all trees having the reason why we are today because of all these trees. Otherwise, it is the only reason why humanity is survives today is because of the trees, that they are providing everything for us, that is almost shelter,
food shelter,
even food is also from plants. Otherwise, without plants we cannot imagine the humanity on this globe. With this remarks, I thank you for participating in the live discussion on the secondary growth in plant and its importance. Thank you. Thanks.